Hello everyone, my name's Katharine Schmidtke, and today I'm going to be talking to you about cloud scale interconnect architectures in the context of hardware and software co-design. I'll start by describing the Facebook application. I'll talk a little bit about AI and ML, and then I'll describe the relevance of software and hardware co-design, particularly for performance improvements, and then talk about network interconnects. So Facebook is a platform that many of you are familiar with. You'll recognize many of these icons, workplace, Instagram, Instagram TV, Oculus, Messenger, WhatsApp. There's over 2.7 billion monthly active users using Facebook at the moment, and Facebook is the biggest social network worldwide. So what do people use the platforms for? They're sharing a lot of information, a lot of messages being sent, over 65 billion messages sent on Messenger. There's 81 billion messages sent between businesses and users on businesses and customers on Messenger. Video, there's 3.5 billion videos that are live broadcast. And now 50% of that data is going through some sort of AI or ML. And I'm going to talk about some of the applications and why we do that, some of the different workloads later in this talk. So that all happens inside one of our data centers. We have 15 data centers now worldwide, and at each one of these locations, each one of these 15 locations, there are six or so data centers at each of those locations. You know, the power footprint here is significant, and we're very concerned about energy efficiency. We've set ourselves the goal by the end of this year to contract for 100% renewable energy and to have data centers that are 80% more water efficient than average data centers. And you can find out more about that at our website, where we go into more detail. So a little bit about the data growth that's been going on in the data centers. This chart shows machine-to-user traffic and machine-to-machine traffic. The green line at the bottom is machine-to-user. So that's that has been growing. It doesn't really show on this scale, but it's been growing steadily and quite dramatically as the number of users increases and the content that they are sharing increases and the amount of time that they spend on the platforms increases. But as you can see from the chart, that's all completely dwarfed by the machine-to-machine traffic. It's about 25 times more bandwidth moving around inside a data center compared to how much actually goes out to an end user. And that's, a lot of it is the machine learning that we're working on to make sure that what goes out to end users is relevant and is optimized. And of course, then there's redundancy and backup, which also consumes bandwidth. So let's talk about those AI ML applications. This is just one example. I thought I'd pick one and show how much that's growing. This is AI inference, and this is over a year and a half period back through just before 2018. And you can see already the amount of inference that we're doing as a workload across our data center is increasing. That ramp at the end has continued, and it's doubling approximately every year at the moment. So we're on a pretty steep ramp here. So what's the workload? What's going on in the data centers? So there are three major workloads, and you can see here over 80% of the workloads is ranking and recommendation. And then the next one is computer vision, recognizing images and tagging faces, and then language to be able to do translation into the different languages that people are sharing and communicating with. So So recommendation models are definitely some of the most important models. And as we looked around at the type of research that was happening, particularly in academia, that research was really centered on computer vision and language, and not so much the piece that we're interested in. And looking deeper into that, we discovered it's because the data sets aren't available and because the benchmarks for the models aren't available. So we've shared that, we've opened our deep learning recommendation model, and that's available on GitHub. So we're trying to encourage research in these areas, and we're happy to provide the tools to enable that. So this is a fairly typical machine learning flow. So obviously it all starts with data, and the more data, the better. That improves the models and the results in the models. And then understanding the features. So what is it that you're trying to get out? And then it goes into a training cycle. So this is training and evaluation, training of the model. And then deployment, where it goes out into the data center and that's where the inference happens. And so that's where the more repetitive inference activities happening. And each one of these is growing in Facebook's data centers. The amount of data that's going into the pipeline is growing. Back in 2018, it was just 30% of the data that was being used. And then last year it was 50%, and that's grown again since then. And the amount of training we're doing, the activities there have grown. We've got more training engineers, we've got more workflows being trained. And then in inference, we're doing a lot more inference. So 400 trillion predictions per day, and 6.5 billion translations happening on the site. And on top of that, you know, a lot of the security precautions that we're taking to make sure that the site is only used appropriately, and a large part of that is removing fake accounts. So all of this machine learning puts a burden on the infrastructure, and I've highlighted a number of the challenges here. There's challenges in the storage environment that goes across the storing the data to feed into the pipeline. And then there are network challenges for moving that information around, both whether moving the data in, performing the training, and then doing the inference. Obviously the just compute processes, acceleration of those models, and memory challenges to have all the right information close for the computations. So this is a lot of strain that goes on the network. And then add on to that, the speed of innovation, how fast this is changing and improving, and the sophistication level is increasing too. So this is another big design challenge for the team. So the only way to get ahead is to co-design the software and the hardware. So that means designing the model to fit what the hardware can do, but then improving the hardware and then feeding that back into the software to allow more sophisticated models. So we've done that in a number of ways. Starting with the hardware, we've created very flexible hardware. And this is an example. This is our inference platform. We call this Yosemite. This is the second version of Yosemite, so Yosemite V2. And the architecture is quite simple, at least when you draw it in a diagram. But it allows us to address high compute and memory capacity with high bandwidth to move the data around and to have the model move at a rapid pace. So there are multiple accelerators, and those are tightly coupled together with very high spec PCIe switch. And this is something we can't build with a single chip, so it gets put into a module that allows us flexibility to configure that module in different ways. And this is something that we've open sourced into OCP. So this is a place for us to share the models, the modules that we've developed. As part of the community, we've made sure that those modules accept accelerators from a number of different suppliers. So here I've listed some of the suppliers that are active in this area. And it's a community-driven approach. So these are all part of OCP and collaborating on this module. And then our training fabric is called Zion, and this is a platform that actually has a number of different networks. So it has a compute fabric, a CPU fabric, and then it has a separate accelerator fabric. And that's to get the performance that we need for this particular training so that the model solves quickly. And this particular configuration, this Ion configuration, offers an aggregate of hundreds of teraflops of B-float 16, and very high capacity. It has terabytes of DDR for very large modules, and hundreds of gigabytes of HBM, so that these parts of the model that need really fast access. To provide the flexibility, we led the formation or the establishment of this accelerator, this OCP accelerator module. So this is a sub module in the platform that can be configured with a number of different accelerators to provide flexibility. And again, this has been shared with OCP. So it's available for anyone in the community to get access to. So I've talked a lot about community and sharing, and this is another opportunity to build community, to build an ecosystem, and that's in the area of chiplets. So before we were talking about the platform and the rack level hardware, this is configuring different functionality by using chiplets that then come together into the module. And this work is being led through the ODSA. So there's a number of different activities going on at the ODSA at the moment in defining open die-to-die interfaces so that each of these chiplets can communicate and are interchangeable. Reference designs, which are a starting point for new designs. And reference workflows. I mentioned, shared a number of different workflows and workloads as references. So these are allow reusable open practices. And then on the right-hand side of this chart, OCP, this is the modularity, the different modules that we're sharing, where these chiplets, that they go onto these modules, and then these modules get built up into servers. Our server rack configuration. So this all allows us to integrate the best in class chiplets from multiple vendors through these open interfaces. And this brings me to network interfaces. So not just chiplet interfaces, but on a much bigger scale. And you can see today, I'm standing inside one of our data centers. This is the wonder of Zoom. And so this is looking across one of the data centers, and this is an aisle in one of the main switch points in a data center. So this is where the building interconnects come together, and this is all cabled with fiber. Today it's all single mode fiber, and these network interconnects also consume a lot of power. So I'm going to talk a little bit about those. Earlier, I talked about how the bandwidth is increasing over time. And while the power per unit bandwidth has been decreasing, it hasn't been decreasing at the same rate that the bandwidth has been increasing. So that leads us to a situation where the power consumed by the network is increasing. And here's some data from 2012, where network looked very small, seemed negligible, build as much of that as you like, doesn't consume much power compared to all the compute and storage in the net, in the data center. Today, that red section has become much more apparent, and we're paying much more attention to it. And then what concerns us is where this goes in the future. It's consuming more and more power, as it's a larger fraction of the total data center power consumption. And as I said before, we are trying to be very careful with the amount of energy that we consume and make sure that that's all renewable energy. And this just makes the problem harder to solve if there's this much power being consumed. So one of the ways that we're hoping to solve this problem is by integrating the photonics into much smaller form factors and moving the photonic interconnect much closer to the host ASIC. So this is an I/O challenge, and burning this much power on the I/O is never desirable. So by moving the photonics in close, those yellow blocks in really close to the ASIC, in this particular case this would be a switch ASIC, this allows us to reduce the power maybe by 20 or 30%, so quite considerable. And integration gets you all the benefits of size as well. So instead of in this picture, it's just four that we have at the edge of a card. By miniaturizing, we would actually got 128 around the switch ASIC. So continuing on the theme of collaboration and working together, this optical integration, we're exploring it in a couple of different forums. We've set up an industry forum working together with Microsoft. We've sent up a joint design foundation, and we've put the requirements as Facebook and Microsoft see them for this kind of technology up on this site. This is the co-packaged optics website, and we've released three documents already that outline the performance requirements for this technology. And then the other place that we're collaborating is on power efficient analog coherent interconnects. So these are longer reach interconnects for our network. And we're collaborating with Clint Scow at UCSB on a program called Intrepid, and that's funded by ARPA-E as part of their Enlightened program. So I'm sure you're going to hear more about that in this workshop today. So in conclusion, there's a number of performance drivers that are, each of them are accelerating, and we're in this catch-up mode. And balanced with that are the practical limitations around energy and energy consumption and all the different ways that we need to be more efficient with our use of energy. So then as solutions to that, I talked about co-design as a way to improve performance and that feedback loop between hardware and software. I talked about chiplets as a way to get flexibility at the chip level, and collaboration as a way that I see it all comes together and that we build and share together and create an ecosystem that supports many different businesses. So that's all I had for you today. Thank you very much for your attention. And if you'd like to reach out and find out more about this work, please contact me at these locations. Thank you.